This video is sponsored by Audible, where you can listen to my audiobook. It's just like this video, only a lot longer, and with no visuals.
Ah, business. Businesses love spreadsheets, and don't get me wrong, I love spreadsheets, but sometimes the spreadsheet can hit the fan. The State Department of Education in Utah miscalculated their budget to the tune of $25 million because of a faulty reference in a spreadsheet. The village of West Baraboo, they miscalculated how much their borrowing was going to cost by $400,000 because when they were summing a range of numbers, they missed one cell off. And in 2012, JP Morgan Chase lost a lot of money. No one's sure exactly how much. Estimates seem to be about $6 billion. This was because of a series of mistakes and errors involving some pretty serious spreadsheet abuse. No one knows the exact details, but in the report that JP Morgan and Chase put out afterwards, they did name one specific spreadsheet miscalculation when they were working out their value at risk. After subtracting the old rate from the new rate, the spreadsheet divided their sum instead of their average, as the modeler had intended. This error likely had the effect of muting volatility by a factor of 2.
Billions of dollars lost because, in part, a spreadsheet summed two numbers instead of taking their average. In fact, the European Spreadsheet Risks Interest Group, Rule Group, I love them, they have calculated that over 90% of all spreadsheets contain an error. Now hang on, how on earth could they possibly know that?
How do you find out from all these businesses what mistakes they've made in spreadsheets? The three examples I had before, they're either cases where it was a public body and so the information had to be released, or in the case of JP Morgan Chase, it was something so obvious that something had gone wrong, they had to release some kind of details. But for the most part, businesses aren't going to want to release their broken spreadsheets, and particularly for the, I don't know, millions? Billions of smaller mistakes and little spreadsheets. How on earth are you going to get a nice representative sample? How do the European Spreadsheet Risks Interest Group, real group, I love them, get their spreadsheets? One day, a spreadsheet researcher named Felienne Hermans had an idea. And that's a real job, by the way. She runs her own spreadsheet lab. It's incredible. Now, she had tried asking companies for their spreadsheets. They were understandably quite reluctant. She had tried Googling for ones that were already publicly available. No joy. And it dawned on her, hang on. When Enron, the massive company, went bankrupt, there was a big court case and they subpoenaed over 500,000 of their internal emails. If she could get those emails, and it turns out she could filter through for all the attachments, which were spreadsheets. And it worked. Of the over 250,000 attachments, over 50,000 of those were spreadsheets. She went through and removed all the duplicates and ended up with 16,189 unique spreadsheets. Sadly, a lot of those were corrupted or password protected. She was able to open and investigate 15,770 of them. And these are real spreadsheets captured in the wild, admittedly from a company which had some suspicious financial practices, so it's not entirely unbiased, but still, these were 15,770 real spreadsheets. What on earth was going on in them?
So what did they find out from those 15,770 spreadsheets? Well, the average size of a spreadsheet is 113.4 kilobytes, although the biggest spreadsheet was 41 meg. What on earth is in a spreadsheet that big that someone had to email around the office? I could almost guarantee it contained audio and pictures and was an invitation to a party. Now, the average spreadsheet had 5 worksheets, 5.1 to be exact, that's not so bad, although one spreadsheet had 175 worksheets. I mean, that's just, even I think that's insane. Now, the average worksheet had 6,191 non-empty cells. So there was something in them. And on average, 1,286 of those was a formula or some kind of calculation, which seems like a lot of calculations. However, 6,650 spreadsheets of the total 15,770 contained no calculations whatsoever. They were a glorified document. I mean, why? I mean, just why even use a spreadsheet if you're not going to do any calculations? So I'm going to discount that 42.2% of spreadsheets which didn't need to be spreadsheets. The researchers took the 9,120 spreadsheets which were actually doing some maths and then searched for the classic Excel errors, things like num and div zero, where you've obviously made a calculation error. And they found that of all spreadsheets doing a calculation, 24% of them contained a very obvious error that Excel had put some kind of message up. That's insane. In fact, of spreadsheets doing calculations, they had an average of 755 such mistakes each. One spreadsheet they found had a record 83,273 Excel math error messages. That's incredible. I mean, at this point, I'm just impressed. I couldn't make that many errors in a spreadsheet without keeping track of the mistakes in a second spreadsheet. All right, let's fire up the old Excel and see what a spreadsheet can do. So let's say I'm using this to store people's phone numbers. So I've got someone called Parker and I'll put in my phone number 01414042559. Only kidding, that's not my phone number. It's my fax number. Now, as you can see, it's obliterated the zero off the front because Excel's gone, oh, that's all digits. It must be a number. You don't need that lead zero anymore, so that's gone. So if you're trying to store a number with a zero in the front, and for a while, this is the past, I had a credit card with a three-digit code on the back, began with a zero. And some websites wouldn't let me enter it because I'll type it in with a zero, it would remove the zero, and then say it doesn't match. So this is a real problem, and you get it in Excel all the time. We can also, if we make the cell too small, hey, the phone number's gone. It's now in scientific notation. Now, in this case, it's actually fine, because if I bring that back out again, there's the whole number. It was just hiding, but it was still there. If instead I change that to be let's make it a serial code, something longer than a number. So let's say Parker's code is 31415926535589. Okay, boom. Okay, scientific notation. However, you go back over, the number's still there, right? It's just hiding up the top there. Let's add some more in. Let's add in 793238, let's say. Okay, so scientific notation. We go back over the cell and, oh, now hang on. Now it ends in zeros. And it's only stored so much. Even if we try and replace that, if we put back in the 3238, add a bit more, 4626433, I think. Now, go to scientific notation, but when you click on the, even up in the bar, like the whole thing is stored as scientific notation. If you put in a number that's too long in Excel, it's like, you don't need all of that. But if it's a serial code, you do need all of that. The other problem is if Excel sees any non-digits, it assumes the whole thing's a word, it's text. And that's not true if you're doing things in hexadecimal. So let's say I've got some numbers I want to put into hex, 19,527, let's say, and 489. Okay, perfectly normal base 10 numbers. Now what I'm going to do over here is put in the formula, deck to hex, my absolute favorite name of an Excel function, and I'm going to do that of the cell next to it, and there you go, right? So it's turned it into hexadecimal, but because there's a letter in it, it's gone, oh, that's just text, and it's put it all the way over on the left, and you think, well, okay, it's fine, it's still there. However, if I now try to, let's say I want to add them, that one plus that one, nope, can't do it. They're not numbers anymore. You gotta put them back into base 10, then add them, then put them back into base 16. And if you were typing them in from scratch, if I come down here, I'll put it next to it. Let's say I was gonna type in 1E9, putting in some hex, and it's assumed the E means scientific notation.
And this is a big problem. If you're putting hex into Excel, it will convert a bunch of the things into scientific notation if there's digits e digits. I spoke to someone at a database company off the record, and they had an issue from one of their clients where the client was like, oh my goodness, we keep losing customers from our database. And it turns out, to generate a code for each customer, they had like a couple digits for the year, then the first letter of the customer's company name, and then some more digits as a kind of code. And sure enough, at some point they were copying it into Excel, re-importing it again, and as soon as it went into Excel, it saw the E and went, that's now a number, that's scientific notation. A friend of mine, Christian Lawson Perfect, actually worked out every single number, which if you convert it into hex, breaks in Excel. It's on the online encyclopedia of integer sequences. You can check it out there. And there are so many other ways Excel can go wrong. I mean, it's finite. Eventually you'll run out of rows. It used to stop after 2 to the 16 rows, which was 65,536. They've now extended it down to 2 to the 20, which is 1,048,576 rows. And I spoke off the record to someone who worked in a government department somewhere in the world. I'm not allowed to in any way give away who or what they were doing, and they were prototyping a new government system that required a database and quite a big public-facing one eventually. And when they were testing it, it kept stopping at a certain point in the day, and they're like, why does it keep stopping at about this time? Turns out they were using Excel as their database to prototype it, and it was running out of rows. Finally, Excel is very, very good at thinking it knows what you're typing and then auto-correcting it. We've seen that with numbers, but let's say you were typing in the name of a gene. On your 10th chromosome, you have a gene which is called, I'm not kidding, March 5. I've typed in the name of my gene. Obviously, it's just text. It's a name. I hit enter, and oh no, now it's a date. And on your first chromosome, you have SEP 15, I think we can see where this is going. Boom, that's a date. And it turns out a lot of gene names, and indeed other things, if they look a bit like a date, Excel will turn them into a date. And that's not just displaying it that way. If you go back over it and you look in the cell, it has actually turned the data into a date. The original name is gone. This would be a major issue if people were actually using Excel to analyze genetic data. But surely people involved in genome research, they're not going to be using Excel, are they?
Do they ever? In 2016, two researchers in Melbourne found 3,597 pieces of publicly available genome research. Attached to those papers were 35,175 different spreadsheets. They wrote some code to automatically download all those spreadsheets, go through them, and search for autocorrect errors. They found 987 spreadsheets which had one or more autocorrect error turning a gene into a date. These were attached to 704 different research papers, which means approximately 19.6% of all genome research has an autocorrect error in an Excel spreadsheet.
The research continues. Dr. Felienne Hermans and her colleagues are still going through both the Enron spreadsheets and other ones to look at the mistakes, find new ones, analyze the emails to work out how people were making and fixing these errors, and a lot of their research and tools is available to download. I will link to it all below, but the moral of this story is, I don't know, don't use Excel as a database. When the autocorrect gene findings were released, Microsoft put out this statement. Excel is able to display data and text in many different ways. Default settings are intended to work in most day-to-day scenarios. I mean, I love the implied genetics research is not an everyday use scenario. So, in conclusion, I'm really quite torn because I love Excel. I mean, everyone's got it. It's really accessible. People can just jump in, do some calculations, mess around with the database. Excel can do a lot, but you do have to be very, very careful with it. As that saying goes, with great spreadsheet power comes great spreadsheet responsibility. Was this whole video an excuse for someone with the surname Parker to say that on a rooftop in New York City? You decide.
As I mentioned, this video is supported by Audible. If you go to audible.com/standupmaths, or you can text standupmaths to 500-500, you can start a free 30-day trial of Audible, and that means straight away you get one free audiobook and two free Audible exclusives. And for your free audiobook, I think we all know what you want to spend that on: my book. So I have made an audiobook version of Humble Pie. You can get that for free. Go to audible.com/standupmaths, and I accept. Maybe you already spend enough time with me on YouTube, and several more hours of listening to me is too much. Audible know that. So they've got a campaign. Anyone who started the new year and you want to improve yourself, if you listen to three audiobooks before the 3rd of March, yes, the three of three, then Audible will give you a $20 Amazon gift voucher. And it's all automatic. So once you finish your 30-day free trial, if you then carry on every month, you get another free audiobook, two free Audible exclusives. If you get all three done, they will straight away just send you your $20 Amazon gift voucher. If you want more than the free allotment of audiobooks, you can get them at a discount rate. So there you are. Please go to audible.com/standupmaths or text standupmaths to 500-500. Not only are you supporting the channel, but of course, you can listen to me for hours for free.